My name is Anton Struwe. I'm the Vice Principal for Institutional Planning of the University of Pretoria. And of course, my whole life I've been a Tukkie, if I could say so. I would like to have a very special word of welcome to our Tuks alma mater. It's really, this event is really here for you and to bring you to the university and to showcase to you, in some cases, what our alumni has achieved in terms of their own careers, but in other cases like today, of what the University of Pretoria is keeping itself busy with. So sometimes we will invite some of our top professors from the university to also present to the alumni and showcase what the university is actually currently busy with. Special word of welcome to our Vice Chancellor and Principal, Professor Cheryl de la Rey. Professor de la Rey is leading by example. University is on a track of excellence, and she's just recently appointed in her second term as Vice Chancellor and Principal, and we really are privileged to have Professor de la Rey with us here this morning. And also then, of course, a special word of welcome to our guest speaker, Professor Mike Wingfield. Professor Wingfield is well known to me in different capacities. In my previous role at the university, I've been Dean of the Faculty of Natural and Agricultural Sciences, and Professor Wingfield reported to me as the Director of the Institute of Forestry and Agriculture and Biotechnology. So, just a few words. When I stood here outside, I had a discussion with one of our alumni, and my mind actually gone back many years in that discussion, talking about the days when the university in the 60s, 70s, when the university was, of course, in a total different era, but where there were certain professors at the university that sort of paved the way. And this particular colleague has been studying engineering and finished his degree in 1964, the table there. And it actually, the stories that came out of the discussion and the names of the professors in mathematics and applied mathematics, which of course is my own discipline, brought some big memories back to me. And I think it's these networks and relationships by bringing our alumni back to the university that actually bring a lot of old new stories back to our minds. And that is actually very exciting to be part of that. Today is specifically an interesting day that looking at the topic, that trees will be the topic of today's discussion, and we've actually invited also some of our students. You'll know, the alumni will know, that we have a tradition here at the university that when you come to your university as a first year student, you are actually part of a legacy of planting a tree at the university, and then that of course keep that legacy going forward in your own life when you visit the campus again. And we have three of our students. You can just see, where are they? Chiamu, Ruan and Felon, where are you? They are our students. They've been part of the students corps that actually participated in this. I think Chiamu, you've 3 years back, you've planted your tree, if I could say so, and is graduating this year, final year. And Ruan, you actually have done that this year. So we will look forward to see how those trees are growing and how you are actually graduating and developing your own careers. But I'm not going to say many more. I would like to invite our Vice Chancellor and Principal to come and give her message to you this morning, and also to introduce our guest speaker. Thank you very much.
Good morning to all our special guests, our alumni, and welcome back to the University of Pretoria. I am very pleased that we have two of our young alumni here. They're still students, and I'm sitting at this table, and there's this huge pillar there. So I'm going to impose on you and ask you just to come forward so our more senior alumni can know who you are. To all our alumni, these are two special gentlemen at the University of Pretoria, and they are doing extremely well academically. And I've had the privilege that, while Ruan's still a first year, at least for now, he's doing very well, he tells me. I've planted trees with both of them, or with each of them, and their trees are doing very well, as they are at the University of Pretoria. And I had planned to say to, well, universities are interesting institutions, partly because universities are such old institutions as an institutional type. We know universities across the world that are more than 500 years old. Of course, in South Africa, our universities are much younger. But of the universities in South Africa, we are among the oldest, now being over 100 years old. And universities like the University of Pretoria can grow and succeed and thrive because of generations of alumni. So in some way today, Professor Struer, those who graduated perhaps in the 1960s, will have an opportunity to meet some of the alumni who are still to graduate, but will carry the torch for us long into the future. So thank you for joining us this morning. And we're really pleased to have students like you as part of our family here at the university. Thank you. I should also tell you that Ruan is a champion swimmer, and he is preparing himself for great things in the swimming world. But when you talk to him, you can ask him more about that. So, ladies and gentlemen, and to our alumni in particular, let me continue with the theme about universities. Universities are, in addition to religious institutions like churches, two of the oldest surviving types of institutions in the world today. So there are churches that can look back and say, this church is from this century. And there are universities who can do that similarly. In modern times, we hear our leaders, including our political leaders, talk about the importance of universities to the development of the modern world. But at the same time, we often get criticized as universities for being too slow to change. And some even criticize us for being a bit resistant to change. But I want to share with you, as I'm sure you've noticed, that universities are changing all the time. So those of you who came here today after a long time will notice how much the University of Pretoria has changed. From the congestion at the front gate as you drove in, the fact that unless we block off this parking area, you wouldn't have had parking this morning. We are expanding all the time. We expand in relation to the changes in our environment. We've come a long way from the type of university that was once thought to be an ivory tower. An ivory tower meaning separate and keeping itself distant and at arm's length from the world out there. On the contrary now, we are very connected to the business world. We are very connected and deeply connected to our local communities. Just to give you an example, last year, our students at the University of Pretoria contributed to 4,000 community projects within a 50-kilometer radius of the university. So that's the city of Tswane, making a difference to local communities. Every student, every graduate at this university is required as part of their curriculum to do some sort of community engagement before they graduate, because we believe fundamentally that we are the community. We shouldn't be distant from the local community. But I'm sure, as you know, that as we've begun to talk about knowledge-based societies, the expectations of universities like the University of Pretoria has changed fundamentally. From the traditional view, that the main role of a university is produced high-level skills, we now have a much broader responsibility in our rapidly changing society. We talk about the role of universities in terms of how we contribute to industrial competitiveness of our country. How do we contribute to job creation? So, for example, every time the university undertakes a major construction project, we are creating jobs. And we are now keeping a record of how many jobs we create. It's part of our contribution to our broader society. But very importantly, the world-class research that we conduct in this university is making a difference to our industrial competitiveness. It's making a difference through job creation, and thereby making a difference to the lives of the citizens of this country. And today we're going to see a fine example of how an institute led by one of the university's top professors meets all of these expectations. I will introduce him formally in a while, but I would like to encourage you to think about the role of the university as a point of connection, that we act as an anchor in a rapidly changing society. And what we do is we connect industry, we connect local communities, we connect government to a centre that is fundamentally a centre of excellence in South Africa. Through research that we're going to hear about, we connect government funding to the objectives of an industry that's fundamentally important for the future of South Africa. Many people have talked about universities as anchor institutions, and I've begun to think about our role as an anchor institution. That although we change, at the very core, we remain the same. And what is the very core of our university? The very core of this university is our commitment to excellence. And how we express that is by taking very seriously our responsibility for producing the next generation of top-class professionals and leaders for this country, like the two students who we've introduced you to this morning. We currently have, as full-time students, just under 50,000 students at this university. The majority of those are in our professional programs: engineering, medicine, dentistry, accounting, auditing, law, theologians, psychologists, and so the list goes on. These people are the employees of all the major, the future employees of all the major companies, not only in South Africa, but across the world. So when I visit our alumni chapter in places like Australia, I find that some of the big corporations in Australia, like the mining houses, are led by graduates of the University of Pretoria. That's what remains core in this university: our commitment to excellence and translating that commitment into the quality of education that we offer our students and the total student experience. I've said, though, how that role has changed, and I think it is epitomized in the work done by our speaker today, Professor Mike Wingfield. So let me say something about Professor Mike Wingfield. He will be addressing us on the theme of a world without trees and lessons learned in establishing a world-class industry university partnership. Professor Wingfield is Mondi, as in the company that I'm sure you all know, Mondi Professor of Forest Pathology. He's Director of the Forestry and Agricultural Biotechnology Institute, otherwise known as FABI, here at the University of Pretoria. He's director of the Tree Protection Cooperative Program and director of the Department of Science and Technology Center of Excellence in Tree Health Biotechnology. Now you might be wondering, how does one person hold all of these positions? But he does, and he does it extremely well. There's much more I could say about Professor Wingfield, but I do wish to summarize very briefly on what constitutes the main pillars of his contribution. The first pillar is the quality and the outstanding quality of his scholarship. He is one of South Africa's very small number of A-rated scientists. And what that means is that his peers globally, other scientists in his field, and in thousands of them, have judged him to be a world leader in his field. There is no place that I've been to, no university in the world that I've visited, who has not heard of Professor Mike Wingfield of the University of Pretoria. I was very surprised when, some years ago, I was invited to Oman, a country I had not ever expected to visit. I was a guest of their government. And when I got to the university there, immediately the Vice Chancellor said, "Professor Mike Wingfield has been here. He's helping us sort out the problem with our date trees." Similarly, in Japan, when I visited there at the beginning of this year, they know the name of Professor Mike Wingfield. Professor Mike Wingfield has a large team at the Institute, and they have become, as an institute, indispensable for the well-being and growth of the forestry industry in South Africa and worldwide. And I hope he's going to say more about this, because he is, in my view, a textbook example of how government funding, which is never enough, can be matched with industry funding to do world-class science, produce top-quality graduates, but also contribute very directly to an industry in South Africa that, when I last looked, employs up to 160,000 or creates 160,000 jobs for this country. Professor Wingfield completed a PhD in plant pathology at the University of Minnesota in the US. He's also got qualifications from the Harvard Business School. I'm going to skip a number of things, Professor Wingfield, and just point out a few highlights. He has been responsible for more than 60 doctoral students from this university in recent times, a phenomenal number by any standard worldwide. If I look at his research publications, he has published more than 600 research papers, including a number of books. There are too many invited conference addresses for me to have counted across his CV. I do want to conclude by saying he's been acknowledged worldwide. He has received an honorary doctorate from the University of British Columbia in Canada, also an honorary doctorate from North Carolina State University in the US, and in 2014 he was elected president of the International Association, which covers his broad area of scientific work. Professor Wingfield, I've been privileged to work with you. His knowledge on trees is exceptional. He goes from advising us about jacaranda trees and tells us what his view is. And as I said, his work and the work of his colleagues in the Institute has changed the way in which the local industry conducts its business in South Africa and worldwide. Professor Wingfield, it's a pleasure to listen to you this morning.
Professor Zillere, thank you very much for your very kind words and for not reading out my CV, but also especially for having me here this morning. I have to tell all of you that when I saw the invitation, I didn't look at what time
this event would take place. When I noticed the time, I thought, well, nobody's going to come here, so I'm quite astounded to see all of you here. And I'd like to thank all of you also for taking the time to come and have breakfast with us early in the morning and to listen to me. It is a great honour. Professor Struer, I also thank you for your words. Now, one thing I'm absolutely sure about is that you all love treats. Well, that's why you're here. I would hope that's the main reason why you're here. And to the students of planting the trees, and I didn't know about that particular program, I do hope your trees grow well, as others have said. They might not, and I say that because we've planted numerous trees over my, 17 years at the University of Pretoria, in honour of various people that have made donations to the work we do and so forth. And some of them have died. And that's very embarrassing. One got hit by lightning. One had to come down because of the road that had to go to the new plant sciences complex. And the person who had planted that tree was extremely upset about that. And we had to make amends, and one has to think of ways to deal with those situations. But bottom line, most of us love trees. I don't think that if one just walked down the street and walked down the paths of the University of Pretoria and went up to people and said, what do you think about trees? I don't think you'll find anybody saying, oh, you know, these are horrible things, or, you know, they're in our way, or, I mean, they are messy sometimes, but most people love trees. I love trees. I mean, I work with trees, obviously, so I mean, I must love trees. But having said that, my perception is that on the whole, we all underestimate the importance of trees in our lives. And I know that I do too. You have to kind of remind yourself. It's like living in, well, Cape Town. You know, the first time you see Table Mountain, certainly the first time I saw this mountain, wow. And I used to look at it, nearly crash a car. I was very young in those days, just looking at the mountain. But after a year or so, you don't see it anymore. You just forget about it. It's gone. And that's what trees are like, at least my perception in our lives. We take them for granted. Now, I've had the opportunity, and it's an incredible privilege, to look at and work with trees in many, many different parts of the world. Projects in just about everywhere you can imagine, certainly on all the continents where trees grow. So where I've gone in the world, and that's a lot of places, they're all places that have trees, including Oman, where there are few native trees. And they are incredible. I mean, I'd love to stand here and take a half an hour and just show you pictures of trees. I have many, and they're beautiful. I have many, many, many pictures of sick trees, too. Somebody asked me for a picture of a sick tree. Yes, that's no problem. I have 100 gigabytes, 200 gigabytes of sick trees. But let me start by just showing you some pictures of trees. This picture is taken in the high Himalayas. I apologize, you know, this venue is not great for looking at slides, but I think you'll get the general idea, and I do apologize for the sun coming through that window up there, which I knew last night when I looked at this room would be a problem. Maybe we need a curtain for that window. So these incredible cypress are up in the tops of the high Himalayas at about 3,500 meters. And if you look out into the background, you can imagine seeing Everest. But Everest is out there, just a little bit higher. Just an absolutely amazing sight. You know, one stands and looks at something like this and thinks, and at the deep forests as far as the eye can see. It's just absolutely incredible. A little bit better, thank you very much. So what about South Africa? Most South Africans don't know about forests. And if I went around this room and asked you individually about forests, you would have different views on what a forest is and what a forest looks like. Probably it would be a view of somewhere getting close to Sadi, God's window, and all those trees growing there. But the big forests of the world are very different to what we know in South Africa as forests. I mean, this is a typical South African forest. I apologize. It's similar to what a typical South African forest looks like. In fact, yeah, I mean, you should have immediately seen that these giraffes don't occur in South Africa. These are reticulated giraffes, and they live only in Kenya, up in the south, near Somalia. Beautiful, beautiful animals, but we have equally beautiful giraffe here. It's different. The giraffe are feeding on acacias, and this is savanna scrubland, what we're used to. But this is the kind of forest that we are used to in South Africa. This is what we call forest. Savanna woodland, scrubland, and it looks pretty bare and scruffy, not particularly impressive, I think you would say. But it's amazing. It's biologically incredibly diverse, and so much depends on it. So the giraffe would not be there if these trees were not there. They're absolutely interdependent. And inside the giraffe's stomach, the bacteria that are there with a lot to do with the trees. And the viruses that live in the bacteria are there because of the same. So the ecosystem, the network of so many parts, are absolutely dependent on the trees. And they're all dependent on each other, of course. So in South Africa, the big tree forests, where are they? Well, we have very, very little. Our forests are what we call remnant forests. They're in the shrinking remnant forests in wet valleys. The Knysna Forest is an example, and some of the valleys down on the Cape, and there's some north of us here. So there is enough water for the big trees to grow. So most of us don't see them, but there are some magnificent big, big trees there. Taking that a step further, the forests you oftentimes think about when people talk about forestry are forests like this. So these are eucalyptus trees growing in plantations in South Africa, part of the South African forest industry that Professor Valerie referred to. The elephant picture is not a joke. It's not something that somebody sort of set up. This is an experimental piece of experimental work done by the South African forest industry to see if there can be some harmonization between nature conservation and commercial forestry. And I can tell you it's a difficult issue. These animals are big and the trees are softer than they are, and the damage can be quite dramatic. But these are the kinds of forests we think about. But what we need to also think about is all of these trees come from somewhere else where they're native in natural, big natural forest. The eucalyptus in this case, mainly from Australia, where there are something like 700 species. And if you see them, if you had the privilege of seeing them in Australia, they're sort of scraggly, they go over the hills, all these species growing in different mixtures, different species growing in different places, on the riversides. That's just natural forest. And we've taken them out, this is what happens, we've taken them out of those natural forests and selected and bred them for particular purposes. Think about that a little bit further. When you eat an orange, it came from a tree, which of course you know, or an avocado, as you see here. These trees are also trees in natural forests. In the avocado case, and I've seen some of the native avocados, they're in forests such as in Venezuela. Big, big trees, amongst many other trees. And you would never think about those trees as being the source of what comes to your table for breakfast or supper. Fruit trees are just trees in natural forests somewhere. And we're so dependent on them in so many different ways. And then, of course, as Professor Delaray already said, they're parts of our lives in terms of the beautification of the world we live in. Can you imagine? This picture is taken right outside my front gate, here in Brooksville, about 5 minutes from here. And this is a scene that we'll all enjoy in a month or so's time. It's been a hot winter. I'm wondering what the jacaranda flowers are going to be like. But can you imagine not having them there? We really do take them for granted. And they're incredibly vulnerable. Professor Delaray has referred to some numbers. The industry, the South African forest industry, 160,000 people employed, but it's the knock-on effect. The 500,000 of the families that depend on those people that are employed. And one can go on and multiply. Multipliers are amazing. Now, these trees, we know, for instance, that 1.6 billion people on Earth depend directly on trees for their livelihoods. They're just there, and somebody planted them once. I've seen these trees in their natural environment also. That's in the south of Brazil and the north of Uruguay. They don't look like they look in Brook Street. You know, they're amongst other trees, and they're pretty, but one doesn't get the impact that we get here. But the important point is that these trees are incredibly vulnerable, and they could easily disappear. And I'll come to a point just now where I'll tell you that they are disappearing. And they're disappearing at an incredibly frightening rate. So what about this world without trees that I'm talking about? What would it look like? Because we need to think about that. Because it is a possibility. I think it's going to look something like this. Also very close to my house. Or perhaps in winter. This is going a little bit slowly. Something like that. So they lost their leaves. That's a little bit in jest, saying this a little bit in jest, but that the concrete jungle in many parts of the world is a reality. And there are places in the world where I go to where all the trees have been cut down to build buildings. If you fly into Singapore and look out of the window, what do you see? Well, you see planted trees, but mostly buildings, and miles and miles and miles of oil palm. Other kinds of trees, but the natural forest is not there anymore. There's just none of it. But this concrete jungle is expanding, and expanding worldwide. So global forests are shrinking, and they're shrinking very dramatically. In the last 8,000 years, 45% of all the trees on Earth have gone. The area that's lost per year is something absolutely incredible. 40, what are the numbers? An area the size of the Western Cape, more or less, disappears every year in terms of natural forest. What's happening? What's this all about? What are the driving forces? Well, I think you all know what they are. Deforestation is probably number one. We're cutting down the trees to make space for agricultural products, to make space for those buildings I was just talking about, and all the other things that we like to have. And we are forgetting how incredibly important those trees are. Somebody said to me at a meeting a while ago, and I can't remember who it was, and I don't know if it was his saying or whether he had read it somewhere else. He said, you know, the amazing thing is that if trees were Wi-Fi dispersers, routers, we would be planting them everywhere. The trouble is they just produce oxygen. And that's what they do. They produce oxygen. And we're cutting them down. This is an incredibly frightening thought. And this picture illustrates, and I'm not going to jump out here, and a little bit hard to see now with the light the way it is, but it shows the shrinkage of forests in the southern hemisphere, the dark green, and I'm colorblind, so when I use colors, don't laugh at me. I think they're dark green. Or tropical forests, they're shrinking the most rapidly currently. And the top part was all pretty well, that's the boreal region, all pretty well deep forested area. And it's mostly all being cut down and shrinking rapidly also. So it's a very, very frightening situation. There are still forests, obviously. 4 billion hectares of them, about 30% of the land surface on Earth. The question is, how are we going to stop them disappearing? So, deforestation, desertification, climate change. Now, climate change is getting close to my own field of research and what I'm particularly interested in. So that's where I'm going. For the rest of the talk, I'm going to be into the issue of tree health, discussing the issue of tree health. There's a lot of argument about climate change and what it all means. And it doesn't mean everything is going to get hotter, for instance. Areas get wetter, drier, hotter, cooler, and there's a lot to say about that, which I'm not going to do today. But I'm going to illustrate and do in this particular picture, which now the sun is moving, and just now it'll be off the screen, but what you see here is just absolute devastation. And this particular picture is in the Grand Teton National Park in the United States. A million hectares of Pinus contorta are dead. And if you go into British Columbia, the numbers are amazing. I think it's 60 million hectares of Pinus contorta dead. And that is due to an insect. And the insect is called the mountain pine beetle. I've been interested in it and played with it when I was a PhD student. I'm interested in it because it carries incredible microorganisms as part of its biology. It carries fungi that I'm very interested in. But this insect has started to kill very, very large numbers of trees. And that's because it's a native insect. It's meant to be there. It's part of the natural ecosystem. The trouble is the populations of the insect would typically drop in winter. So the cold of the winter in that area controls the populations, and because of climate change, that has changed, and the populations have built up, and there's absolute devastation, and it's continuing and moving eastwards. So the size, if you're interested in this particular topic, just go on the web. There are many, many statistics. There are millions and millions and millions of tons of wood people don't know what to do about and do with. Artists are painting about the beetles and the trees and just, you know, terrible concern. It's certainly one of the greatest calamities in terms of natural ecosystems that has ever occurred in recorded history. There are other issues that are really important, and that is where our research in FABI, some of our research focuses, and that's in terms of diseases. And that's diseases caused by alien invasive organisms. And I could spend a great deal of time giving examples, and I always have the fear that you'll think, well, that's just one example. The trouble is there's so many of them. The pictures here you see are on the one side, mountainside in Austria, with elm trees dying, and the other picture I took as a PhD student, and it's the Minnesota State Fairgrounds, where there, at that time there were a few remaining American elms. And artists are invited to come and carve out, I think they were doing it with chainsaws, artworks from the dead trees, using the dead trees. So this, I call it like a monument. There's a dead tree here, it's a beautiful, large sculpture. I call a monument to the American elm. What happened there? A disease caused by a fungus arrived. It arrived in Europe, went to North America, and it's moved around in the most amazing ways. But it has devastated entirely the species. The American elm is pretty well gone. One still finds the trees, one can protect them, but you can't protect thousands of trees. As a component of the natural ecosystem, it's been destroyed. Same thing in Europe. The English elms. And the story of Dutch elm disease is amazing. Much has been written, and much has also been written in the popular press, and story books, and illustrated non-scientific books. And then we have many, many, many other examples of exactly the same thing. Chestnut blight and white pine blisterus and pinewood nematode that I believe was discussed or illustrated at an important lecture here on campus last week. That was the subject of my PhD. I've decided not to show you pictures of that. And then you think about plantation forestry, what's happening there, going back to those eucalypts and pines. Well, unfortunately, the same thing is happening. It's magnified in a different way. So what you see in this picture is devastation of Pinus radiata. At this point, the point the photograph was taken, you see the helicopter, I'm sitting in the helicopter, so there's a shadow there, about 85,000 hectares of trees dying. The important part is Pinus radiata is the keystone species of the forest industry of Chile. And this picture is taken in Chile. Became a really exciting PhD project here at the University of Pretoria. Some very important papers written, well cited, that's very exciting. For us, for the scientific enterprise, but for industry, the devastation is terrible. It's not only the loss of the trees, and that's of course important, it's the fact that you cannot grow those same trees in these areas anymore. And it's all the knock-on effects again. So 100 years of history of learning how to plant these trees, where to plant them, how to cut them, how to dry them, how to make the products that we make from trees is lost because those trees are gone. Something else has to be planted. And unfortunately, this story, it's just a repeating theme. There are many, many, many examples. I have to show a South African picture. Although I don't think there are any members of the South African forestry industry here, I was told, so a little bird whispered in my ear that some of my colleagues in the South African forest industry said, we don't need to pay to listen to Professor Wingfield. We listen to him for free, which is an interesting idea, which is actually true, but I think a little cheeky as well. So devastation of pines in South Africa, devastation of pines and eucalypts, and lots of examples. This caused by a wasp, and you can see here, a very beautiful wasp called the Cyrus wood wasp. An incredible story, insect that lives in an obligate association with the fungus. They need to be together. We've done lots of research on this particular problem. At this particular time that the photograph was taken, the losses were about 350,000 rand, 350 million rand to our forest industry. And a big part of what we're doing is trying to deal with these kinds of situations. So bottom line here is that pests and diseases are moving around the world. They're influenced by climate change, but that's just a little piece of the whole story, and it is becoming more. They are becoming more and more serious issues. So this graph, and I've got really kept graphs and scientific data out of this talk, because I want to get a message across, I want to bore you with lots of tables and graphs. And what you see is cumulative numbers. In this case, this is black wattle. Some people hate it, so they love this picture. Really, some people, to some people, what's an important commercial tree is a weed. So there are lots of sides to these stories and tensions, and interesting tensions. But what you have over a period of time, starting 1910 or 1900 to now, it's just the diseases, the numbers of diseases that are affecting these trees in South Africa. And if you put the insects there, it's just the graph is just higher. It's just more impressive. And that continues to happen. Well, what does that mean for an industry like forestry industry? It means that the job is getting more expensive, so the return on investment is smaller and continuously smaller. And that's a huge problem. Unfortunately, what happens is one eventually reaches what we call a tipping point. And that sounds a little dramatic, maybe a little scary, scaremongering, somebody said to me once. The trouble is, I have the opportunity as I move around the world to see the tipping point. And so you have your, you look uncomfortable, you're welcome to turn it on. So what happens is more and more and more problems until it's no longer possible to retain or sustain these industries. So for instance, the avocado industry need to be really, really worried now, because there's a new disease that is infecting avocado and native trees related to avocado in the southeastern United States. And if that disease gets here, there may not, there probably won't be an avocado industry. Some of you have seen in the popular press the statements that the banana is gone. And it's another story which I won't tell today. But this is a huge, huge problem that is surrounding us, that's affecting us, and that we are generally not thinking enough about. The industry said, well, it's not going to happen to me until it does. So you take that tipping point, and I'll give you an example. One of the most important forestry trees grown in plantations in the world is a tropical species, comes from Australia, called Acacia mangia, and it's planted over many, many millions of hectares in Southeast Asia. And a disease popped in to that, arrived in that resource. I was the person who discovered the disease not long ago, 2005. Essentially, I'm not really meant to say this, I suppose, but I believe it passionately, that the species is gone. And here, huge areas, little white piles, these piles of wood that's taken again from the helicopter flying past here, just people cutting down all the trees because too many of them are dying to have a profitable business. So it's then a collapse of an industry. It's a very, very frightening situation. So the question in your mind must be, what's driving this? What are the major driving forces? So the major driving forces is us, unfortunately. People and our products moving around the world and taking with us insects and fungi and bacteria, organisms that kill trees. These alien invasives that arrive in these areas and start to cause absolute devastation. And there are two sides to the story. One is the devastation to commercial enterprise, avocado, fruit tree industries, forest industries. That's the one end. And I can feel a little bit optimistic at that side, and I'll tell you why just now. The other side is the natural forest. Really, in that situation, there's almost nothing that can be done. Once one of these disease or insect problems starts to emerge, it's impossible to stop. It's a very sad situation. But we're the guilty party, and what you should see in this picture, it's a remarkable picture. I like to look at it, and it illustrates it's a compacted time lapse. It illustrates air traffic in the world. It was produced some years ago. And you'll see it again. It's daytime in South Africa there, so quite a lot of air traffic, and it changes as the 24 hours. It's compressed over a 24-hour period. And you can see where the activity is. And if one superimposes on the shipping traffic, it's just like a yellow black, just a yellow picture. We are moving huge, huge amounts of cargo all over the world. And with that, and we're moving, with us and with the products that we're moving around, we're moving these agents of disease. An interesting way to think about this is very long ago, we had what was called Pangaea. So there was one continent, one landmass, and that started to break up. Our continental drift. And speciation occurred, so trees started speciating different species in different parts of the world. And one way to think about that is that with air traffic and shipping, we're bridging all the continents. So we're returning, in a way, to Pangaea. But the impact on the plants that we rely on for food and for forestry is absolutely devastating. So, the question in your mind is, what are we going to do about it? And I've already said, in the natural forest situation, it's a very, very difficult issue. We obviously work on these issues. But can we do anything? Well, we can do many things, and that's what we do in the research program that I lead in FADI. So I want to tell you a little bit about that and get a bit to the industry situation. FADI has an interesting background, and the picture here shows some of that background. So if you don't know Fabiat, buildings, well, they're in very, very numerous different places on the campus, but some of them just on the passage here. So the people standing in the corner and blowing out candles on a birthday cake, and that was to celebrate the 21st birthday of a program called the Tree Protection Cooperative Program. Professor De La Rey referred to that. Tree Protection Cooperative Program now is in its 27th year, and it was started not here, but at the University of the Orange Free State. So we started a program, it had only two people in it, myself and a secretary. We also was taught to do some laboratory work, so kind of like a secretary technician, because that's what we had to do. And this has become the largest single program focused on tree health in the world. It was at the start of the University of Free State, a strange place to start a tree health program, not many trees there. And we moved to the University of Pretoria now 17 years ago. And here you see the other pictures, some of our facilities and people working in what is now FABI. So the TPCP was the engine that started FABI. So there was an engine that got it going. And FABI we formally moved into our first buildings, and Billy, it's very nice to see you here because you designed fabulous buildings for us and we still enjoy them. We made some mistakes, and I saw you come in here. I should talk to you about some of the mistakes. But our Vice Chancellor won't potentially like some of what I would say, because one of the mistakes is when we built the first building, we should have built 4 or 5 stories. And every Sunday when I walk around the neighborhood, I walk towards Fabi. So I look across the fence, and I see the one big building, and I see this little building, and I think of the space limitations we have, and think, really, that building needs to grow. The trouble is, what do we do if we grow it? Because we're busy working in there, and that has to happen when I'm not here anymore, because I've done too much building in my career. But Fabi has grown to something very, very special, with a very substantial international footprint, and it's really a remarkable place. It's a remarkable privilege for me to be able to be there and to lead Fabi. What you see here is, I think this picture is intended to illustrate some of the heart of Fabi. The picture on the one side is some of our students out in the field, and we are working all over the country and the world all the time. What I think they're trying to do here, they're trying to make a Fabi logo. So let me see if I can see who is Andy Wilson. The first one is making an F and then an A and a B and an I or something like that. But the important message really is the energy, the enthusiasm, the spirit, because that's what really makes Fabi what it is. It's the people that make Fabi so very special. So the main Fabi buildings we occupied, our first space was in the big grey building on the 6th floor, and it's still very full there as well. So Fabi is not a place. Our physical facilities are spread around the campus. But you see the first building, Billy, which you remember well, Fabi Square, came in 2005, and some of our team working out in the field. And in the next picture you can see the opening, so when we formally inaugurated Fabi, this happened some years after we moved in because we had to make it all work. So you see, there I am, re-signing contracts with forest industry people and Johan van Sel, who used to be here, as I think you all know, opening the plaque in front of the first building. And then in 2005, as I've already said, we inaugurated Fabi Square. It should have been 7 floors, but it's still a fabulous place to be. Well, and Vice Chancellor smiles at these comments, but perhaps doesn't know some of the detail, but it was designed for 7 floors, and Billy will know that we spent a third of the budget underneath the building so that they could go up. And the roof on top of the building is a solid roof, and what you actually see is for aesthetic purposes. It's a soft roof, but there's a solid block. So we spent a huge amount of money. And then there were some changes, and we didn't grow up. But here we're inaugurating the building, and we're planting trees. And unfortunately, the tree that the student representative planted died, and she was very, very upset. And we've replanted the tree, and I looked at it yesterday, and I think it's doing okay. Trees are sometimes hard to grow. So Fabi has had a huge role to play in dealing with these issues of tree health. And I'll talk a little bit more about that now. But we've been lucky in some ways. The energy, the success of the beginning of Fabi led to growth, as you can see here, and it's been continual over a long period of time. We've had had wonderful opportunities. I think the acknowledgement or the selection of the team at FABI as one of the first six centres of excellence in South Africa. So these are the Department of Science and Technology, National Research Foundation, Centres of Excellence. There were six initially, and I think the number is up to something like 15. And you might recognize some people in this picture. For instance, our Vice Chancellor looking... I'm not going to say that. I'm going to say looking surprised. So she was then the, I think, Deputy Vice Chancellor Research at UCT. So she's representing UCT, who got one of the Centres of Excellence. Professor Crewe now retired. And other very interesting people in the picture. Minister Mangena was Minister of Science and Technology at that time. What a remarkable person, and how wonderful now to read. I think he's writing a commentary, I think it's every week, and I've seen two of them in the Mail and Guardian, and he has some very wise things to tell us. A really, really remarkable South African that I had the privilege to spend quite a bit of time with over the years. So this incredible institute with a worldwide reputation, grown to have a worldwide reputation in a short period of time, is focused on many different things, but tree health is one of them. You'd say about half of the institute. The institute is 200 people, about 150 masters and PhD students, a core leadership team of 24 academics, something like 30 or so postdoctoral fellows, and a small core of support staff. Half focused very strongly on this issue of tree health. But what do we do? How do we deal with these diseases? Well, I've said in the natural forest, it's almost impossible. And I'm not going to go into that issue here and what we might do. But in the plantation situation, it's quite easy. So I have phone calls regularly from people, public in South Africa, elsewhere in the world, saying, I have this magnificent tree in my garden and it's dying. And I have to say, and it's a sad situation, I have to say, well, I have I've had some magnificent trees in my garden too, and they have died. And I've had to have them cut down at great expense. And if you have palms in your garden, you probably know the story, because palms are dying all over Pretoria. I won't go into that detail now. In a plantation situation or an orchard situation, one has much more control. So in this picture, you see some black trees on one side, white trees on the other side, and the ones that are black because they're oozing resin because they're infected by a fungus. Turned up here many years ago, we discovered it. The thing has got a scientific name, of course. It's got a nice South African twist to it. And we called it, at that time, we called it Coneotherium zuluense. And Zulu because it was in Zululand, KwaZulu-Natal. And for it was a very bad name because it wasn't known anywhere else. We thought this is something about Zululand. It came from the natural environment. In fact, we know that it didn't now, and it comes from somewhere else, and that makes it a bad name. Because the disease now occurs in many different countries and it's causing huge devastation. But if you look at these trees on the right-hand side, those are trees that have been selected for resistance to the disease. So you can imagine those black ones having millions, they're just millions and hundreds of billions of spores ready to infect, but they're not doing anything to these trees. So that's one sort of thing we do with the forest industry in South Africa. We work with them and assist them to understand how these processes work, how infection occurs, and how to find trees that are not going to become sick. And I'm saying that in a very simple way, but that's one of the driving forces. So we're putting fundamental science behind what they do in a practical way. And sometimes it's hard to convince industry partners that they need to understand the fundamentals, because they just want to fix it and fix it quickly. And say, get doom spray and run around. And I could tell you many fascinating stories about doom spray and CEOs of companies screaming and shouting about spray them now and do some crazy stuff, or spending $4 million spraying nothing because they don't know when the thing is meant to be there. Say, well, what are you spraying? And what are you going to spray with? And what about the people that are walking around there? And then you hear the spraying happen and $4 million is spent, and you think, for heaven's sake. And a CEO of a company once said to me when I was making this comment, I said, but we have to be seen to do something. We just have to do something. I might even say later it worked, but I can tell you it didn't. Another tool that we have that's really important and something we're doing at an increasing scale is dealing with biological control. So for insect pests, we can get their enemies and bring them here. It's not a simple process, it's a very complicated process, and again, the fundamental science is really important. Understanding where they come from, how they live, what they need to live on, what the genetics of their populations looks like, because you want to know if they're going to be sustainable populations, and many, many important basic questions. So the pictures here illustrate some of biological control, maybe a good opportunity to thank our Vice Chancellor, Professor Lurie, for the support that the university has given us to establish a biocontrol facility, and they're on the research precinct, or the experimental farm, as some people have called the space. Incredibly exciting, important space on the campus of the University of Pretoria. And what's happening there is some very, very important basic science and some very practical work that enables our forest industry to deal with the very rapidly growing number of insects that are eating their trees. So biological control, really important. And I've just touched a little bit now on this issue of solving problems. So what industry wants, what orchard growers, fruit industry, forest industry, any industry wants is what? They want to make money. And that's something I learned at Harvard Business School. And sometimes I think back to the lessons I learned. When one is surrounded by CEOs and to be CEOs of companies, one learns very quickly that the focus is very, very directly, and to those of you who are in those positions, I hope not to be insulting, I don't want to be insulting, I understand the business very well, but the focus is on bottom line, cash flow, return on investment, maximize profits. And I remember the classes that we had every day. The professor at Harvard was teaching finance, a very, very clever man, would walk in and he just wrote on one thing. Said, don't run out of cash. And Professor Lurie, you think about that probably every single night when you go to bed. Because when you run out of cash, whether you're the principal of the university, or the director of an institute, or a CEO of a company, or a homeowner with two children, when you run out of cash, you are bankrupt. And then you're in really, really serious trouble. The young ones are on that are here. Think about never run out of cash. So matching, and there's a point I want to make, is matching the needs and the focus of industry with what the focus of a university is trying to do. Take some special skill and a lot of effort, and sometimes it's very, very frustrating. What is the university, what are the value propositions? What does the university want? The university is has a business. It is a business. It's a business about education. I'm talking about the principal. It's about education. So that is students, well-educated, reputation, of course, and all those things that go with that, to produce international stature through publications. But this is what we do. That's our business. And we shouldn't be too worried about where the Mondi is making money. That's their problem. That's their business. What they want is to make money. And our member organizations, the members of the Tree Protection and Cooperative Program, will say, yeah, we really love these students. Really nice energy. I think they're wonderful, and they do care. These are good people. But they don't care a lot, because the thing they really care about is their value proposition. And it should be that way. So now what we've got to do is we've got to make music out of these two different, very, very different instruments. And that for us, I think, is one of our biggest challenges, but it's also exciting. The way we have to do it is we have to show that the work, the basic work, is crucial to the practical answer. And one can't just do one side, one's got to do it all. And reputation, being seen as leaders, not only here, but in the world, and I can tell you many stories of how we've had these kinds of discussions with industry. And they'd say, well, there must be a solution, and then they'll write letters to people around the world and say, how are we going to fix this? And the letters, they usually come back to me and say, why are these people asking us these questions when you're the leaders in the world? Right there at their doorstep. Because they think that somewhere there's a magic cure or a silver bullet. Somewhere it's going to be there. So our reputation, not only in South Africa, but internationally, is crucially important. And the way that we have to drive that, I'm close to the end, if you're worried. And I can tell you that I think I'm still in time. Our reputation is built on top-class research and engaging with our collaborators around the world. So having science, the basic science coming out, this picture comes from a paper in Nature that came out of the Fabi team very recently. has an enormous impact. People around the world say, well, those are the leaders, those are the people that are willing to do fantastic work. I've been thinking about this a great deal in terms of what we do with these kinds of data, the genome in this case, the publication of 7 years of work, many authors, the genome of the eucalyptus tree. Those data, the information there, is so rich and enables us to understand disease and insect on these trees. So not only, I mean, of course the industry is interested in wood properties and those kinds of things, but the disease and insect side that I'm more interested in, particularly focused on, there's an enormous amount of strength there. And I've been thinking about this a great deal. And one very seldom sees important leaders in the business world writing scientific papers. That's always a shock. At the beginning of this year, there was a paper in the New England Journal of Medicine that the title took my interest. And then I saw who wrote the paper. And that was a very famous businessman who is known to all of you. Bill Gates. The New England Journal of Medicine, one of the most prestigious journals in science. And this, in this case, medical science. And what Bill Gates is talking about here, is the title is The Next Epidemic, Lessons from Ebola. And it's a short paper, but it is really remarkable, and it's really worth reading. What he is saying is what happened with Ebola is absolutely terrible. 10,000 or so people dead. Most shouldn't have died. We have the technologies. We have currently the technology to prevent that sort of thing happening. And there's a lot of detail that I'm not going to talk about here. But we have those technologies, and he says, lessons for Ebola, because there is more Ebola coming. There are more of these kinds of pandemic diseases are one of the greatest threats to the human race. And trees and people are very similar for various reasons, which I can talk about at another time. We both live for a long time, so we have that kind of vulnerability. Johan von Zell said to me a year or two ago, he said, we put a lot of our money into understanding pandemic diseases, because that's insurance, that's what they're interested in. Because that's one of the greatest threats to their business, but people on Earth. So, and around that theme, I'm thinking about what Bill Gates was saying. About at the time the paper came out, I was invited to write a paper in a very prestigious scientific journal called Science. And the paper, amazingly, I think it was planned for this event, appeared last night at 8 o'clock. We knew it was coming. 1400 Eastern Standard Time. That's American time. So we're waiting at 8 o'clock. We've written the paper, we know what's in the paper, but what we hadn't seen was final print, and I wanted to get the final print. I wrote to the chief editor this week and said, can't we have a copy? Absolutely not. It's embargoed. The only copy you've got says confidential all over it. I wanted to see what would happen. And last night, I was at a function, and suddenly, Bernard Slippers, one of our wonderful team members, sent an SMS with a picture. And the picture wasn't this paper, it was the cover of Science, where the paper is featured. So we not only have our paper published in this great journal, but we also are featured on the cover. Professor Ray, I brought you a copy, so you can look at it. Unfortunately, the library site was down this morning, so we still only have the embargo print of the main paper. We'll get that one to you later, but the copy of the cover is there. So really, really exciting, and it's important for us, because this also builds our reputation. It's good for the university, it's good for us as individuals, as scientists, and it's wonderful for us in our relationship with the industries that we support. So I'm going to end with just a few points, some final thoughts, and I'll go through them quickly. I said in the title, when I offered a title, some lessons learned, and I've already talked about some lessons. But let me summarize just a few of them that I think are maybe key contributing factors to the success of Fabio, to the growth and the success of Fabio. One is certainly internationalization. This picture comes from an article in Nature a few years ago which focuses on collaboration in the world. And it shows areas of the world with the highest impact in science and the greatest collaboration. And you can see exactly where it is. Collaboration internally and internationally is absolutely crucial. And that's been one of the drivers of the success of our program. We have projects all over the world. People from all over the world working in Fabi, hugely culturally diverse. And those collaborations have really helped us to attain international recognition and therefore also the credibility to engage with governments and industry. The next one, critical mass. Oh, sorry, one ahead. Next one, So one of my favorite books, if you haven't read it, it's a little book, easy to read, and really, really interesting. It's called The Medici Effect, and there's a little statement on the top, and it says something like, and I can't see it from here, it says something like, if you read this book and you can't come up with at least two Mona Lisas, you're not even trying. And what it focuses on is the power of the intersections, and that is the intersections between disciplines. So in Fabi, we intersect a huge number of disciplines, and that's been that pertain to plant science. We started with this desire to bring DNA technology into the University of Pretoria in a different way. Now it's just there all over the place. And it's a long story, but it's the intersections, the ability of our students to hear about all sorts of different things, from bucket and spade and cutting down trees to DNA sequencing and genomes and GMOs, and those intersections drive the quality and the lateral thinking of our science. So that's been very special in Fabi. That it's not just to break, I think as Johan von Zell said to me years ago, to break the pillars, the chimneys, and get out. And I remember a beginning Senate meeting, Cheryl, before your term, where the principal stood up and said, I think we should close all departments, we should just flatten them all and just have one department. Well, the idea is a very, very interesting idea. It's not terribly practical. But this idea of forcing the intersections between music. Last night, in the function I attended, there was a musician playing, and it was an incredible experience. So there were scientists and music all together. Another one, the critical mass that I just mentioned. So the people you see here are about 100, so it's half of Fabi. Mostly graduate students, and they're all working in the field of tree health. So being able to have numbers of people working in the field, sufficient numbers to have continuity. Now, this is a problem in universities for professors. You have a professor has a student learns an incredible technique, goes away, you start it all over again with the next student, teach them the technique, takes a year or two, and then they go away again, and so this happens. So what we work at very hard is to make sure that we have sufficient critical mass for the energy, for the interaction, and also for the continuity. So that's a key factor. The next one is diversity, cultural diversity. The picture here, and Wilhelm, I know you're here somewhere, Wilhelm de Beer, one of our team members, one of our stars, and we have many shining bright. Wilhelm is very artistic, and for our end of year season greeting card, we produced a card that illustrated some of the languages that's spoken in Fabi. And at any one time, there are between 25 and 30 mother tongue languages spoken in our team. So there are people, and if you'd seen the previous picture, you'd have seen faces of people from all over the world, and all different parts of our society. So the diversity, and many people ask me, to what do you attribute the success of Fabi? I said, well, I know one thing for sure. It's cultural diversity. Some people say we're overly focused on social engineering. We move people around. You know, we want people to learn to understand different cultures, and it drives the quality of the science too, in amazing ways. Dealing with industry, our relationship with government and industry, really important. This picture just illustrates us in the field. You see a car with a lot of logos. You know, we have so many different collaborators that it's becoming very difficult, and we get complaints. You know, recently, the THRIP program said, why isn't the THRIP logo there? And so we'll put it there, and the UP logo is not there, so we put the UP logo on the roof maybe, or, you know, so, but our relationship with industry is crucially important, and that demands an understanding from both sides. And I want to show this picture very briefly just to illustrate another issue, and that is the issue of leverage. So what you see, again, I'm not good in colours, so the pink I think is the University of Pretoria. So the pie chart here illustrates about in the region of 40 million rand of funding. That's the funding that the Tree Health Programme depends on. Half of it is the University of Pretoria. And it enables these other pies to exist. And every one of them depends on each other. So you see the DST, you see the forestry industry in various ways, you see government here, Mondi, THRIP, the university, and others. But this is about leverage. So what we continuously do is have the power of leverage. So the university's contribution, very substantial, our salaries essentially and some facilities, makes this other piece possible. And Professor Leray, again, thank you for that support. Because without the university, you can't do this, but without this, you can't do the other. So leverage is a hugely important issue, and certainly the success of Fabi relies on that. So I'm going to end with one slide, and it's a very strange slide. It's not a beautiful tree, it's a sick tree. So I thought I'm going to end with a sick tree and I'll tell you a very, very quick story. So what you see here is a disease of eucalyptus, which we call cryphonectria canker. It causes these horrible malformations of the stem. The trees fall over, they break down. And we've spent 30 years and many PhDs and masters studying this disease. And what I want to illustrate is relationship with our stakeholders, government and university and industry. When we inaugurated our first building at the University of the Free State, and I suppose the TPCP was then maybe 5 or 6 years old, there was a function, the CEO of SAPI was there, we were talking, and I was talking about cryphonectria canker, and at some point I was called away for a very important telephone. I was told I need to leave, and I need to answer the telephone. There's a call from the minister's office. So I went to my telephone and grabbed it, and it's the secretary to the minister, and said, "Professor Wingfield, we need to know more about what you're talking about, the radio coverage and those sort of things." And I said, "What are you talking about? What do you want to know?" And he said, "But what we understand is you have named something for the minister." And I said, "I don't know what you're talking about. You have to explain to me, because it was really a bizarre telephone call." So I said, "Well, what is this thing?" She says, "Cryphonicky." I said, "What?" "Professor, cryphonicky. Cryphonectria canker, that's a fungus name. And the minister that she was talking about was a man called Cryphonicky. And the government had thought..." And I think he was the minister of, I don't know what he was, the minister of Environment Affairs or Forestry, but they thought that we were naming something for the minister, and they wanted to understand better what we were doing. But what it illustrates is the story. Government watching us, industry watching us, our stakeholders, and from my perspective, one of the most important challenges that we have as academics at university is to learn the language of our stakeholders. You know, they really don't understand scientists. Government and industry people do not understand scientists. The sad part is scientists don't understand them. So we've got a mess. They just don't understand each other. So we've got to learn their language. They're not going to learn our language easily, so we've also got to help them to understand our language. And if we can get that right, we have the partnerships necessary to do more of what we've been doing in FABI. So thank you very much for listening to me. It's been a pleasure to be here, and I'm happy to answer questions over breakfast. Thank you very much.
Special guest, I'm going to, before I thank Professor Wingfield, do ask if there are one or two, or at most three questions that you would like to ask to Professor Wingfield. I think he gave us quite an interesting display of the complexities that you have when you actually develop these relationships, when your work requires you to develop these relationships with government, industry, and so forth. But let me open it up for some questions.
I hope I didn't confuse you.
Please. I would like to know, you mentioned the devastation of the insects, etc., and deforestation. What about forest fires? That would surely be
huge.
One of the biggest problems.
So the question about forest fires. Forest fires are a huge issue, and of course they are also linked into and related to some of the deforestation. So. You know, if one is in Southeast Asia, the burning of the forest, cutting and burning, and then the spread of those fires, they're a huge, huge issue. And there are obviously other issues I've not talked about, but very of very great concern. So I'll speak at the World Forestry Conference in 2 weeks' time, going to be held in Durban, great honour for South Africa, and I need to talk about resilience, and you know, one has to get the fire issue in there. The trouble is there are so many different threats, but of course fire is really important.
What would be the impact be of commercial forestry being established inside the forested area?
Well, commercial forestry is inside the forested area. A lot of where commercial forestry was forest, some of it was felt. Also, so very important. So, you know, if one looks at aerial photographs of commercial forestry in South Africa, you'll see the riparian zones that are now all left pristine. From a tree health standpoint, I'm really interested, because inside that natural forest, there are also very interesting insects and fungi that want to eat what the commercial forestry people are growing. So we have studies where we're trying to understand the movement from native forest onto commercial forest trees and vice versa. But in the big picture, if you look to, say, commercial forestry in South Africa, much of it is where forest was, and there's still some forest left there. So forestry will plant wherever they're able to and can in a responsible way. And an important point to make here about forestry in South Africa is all of commercial forestry in South Africa is FSC certified. It's a feather in the cap of the South African forest industry, where they've shown that they take environment really seriously and trying to do so more all the time.
Thank you. Any last question?
One more, that's the number three.
Please.
Good morning, Prof. Thank you very much for the presentation. I just want to understand something with regard to the stakeholders. In dealing with stakeholders, which may be government and private sector, who do you think between the two, and I'm not comparing the two, but I just want to know their approach. I just want to know their approach between the two with regard to taking care of the natural resources and trees on them. So who do you think has come on board with regard to that? So who are supporting these type of initiatives from the private sector and the public sector? And do you think there's anything that can be done, maybe in terms of legislations, to enforce such type of initiatives? Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for the question. It's one that's really interesting to me, and it's a very complex issue. So who's on board? Well, government and industry are speaking, and that's an important issue. And they're speaking more and more. So I'll give you just one example. Recently, the DST established what they call the Sector Innovation Fund to put money into forestry research in South Africa. So there is government coming on board and saying, we're committed. Whereas for many years, government wasn't putting money into the improvements and the future sustainability of forestry. And the industry was funding pretty well all of, for instance, research. So, you know, it's never one side. There has to be partnership. Now, I'll tell you one thing. In my dealings with DST, they are watching very carefully and saying, we're putting money in, but we don't want to see less of your money coming in. We want to see more of your money coming in. So the two sides, again, understanding each other and being honest and fair. But it's everything. It cannot be one or the other. There are tensions, of course, and there will always be tensions. Tensions about water issues, for instance. Alien invasive weeds, so some of the trees that forest industry plant that are undesirable to various sectors of society and government. So it's this balance between all these different things. But really, I think the answer to your question is it's both, and both are well on board, and I think those relationships are improving substantially. So I'm very happy about that. And I get to speak back to back with a number of ministers in a couple of weeks' time. So I hope to also emphasize that point and encourage the relationship.
Thank you very much. I think we've taken too much time away from your breakfast. I think everybody's thinking about that. So I'm going to end this discussion by thanking Professor Mike Wingfield. I think Professor Wingfield clearly sort of illustrated and echoed what the Vice Chancellor has said, that the universities can't actually position themselves in ivory towers anymore. It's the kind of challenging questions that we have to address needs partnerships between society, industry, government, and so forth. And I think this illustrated quite uniquely to us how this could be achieved by a world-class institute. I'm going to thank Professor Wingfield by giving him a small token of our appreciation. And I know that Professor Wingfield receives many awards and many of these, so, but the university is really appreciating your contributions, and you can be assured of our support in future. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
To our alumni, you have noticed that Professor Wingfield, in the tactics that he presented his presentation here, indicated that money is very important, and that as a university, in terms of our students and so forth, that needs to have financial support, we actually need also our communities, and our alumni is a very important part of our community to support us in that. So I'm going to, just as a last item on the agenda, going to invite Ms. Cheryl Benali to, and I know Cheryl, she's a very talented person, so I'm going to ask her to keep her short presentation to 3 minutes, if it's possible. Just to introduce to you possibilities in terms of becoming a part of this university's contribution to make this university a sustainable and the one that we want to search for excellence. So thank you very much. Thank you for joining us. And I hope you will join us at our next breakfast occasion again. That will take place. Let's see the date here. On the 16th of October, and the speaker will be Mr. Terence Nombembe, CEO of South African Institute for Chartered Accountants, that will speak at our next occasion. So we want to invite you all. In the previous breakfast session, we've got almost 20,000 rand of contributions, and I hope this one would actually overtake that one. So thank you for your support. Cheryl.
Good morning, everyone. As Professor Delarue mentioned this morning, being connected to ourselves, our community, and to the world around us involves active participation. Leonardo da Vinci, the great artist, mathematician, inventor, and writer, implores us to learn how to see, to realize that everything connects to everything else. The role of academics in society is to help us see, which is why Prof. Wingfield has helped us to do this morning. One of the primary ways that we see our interconnectedness is through the power of story. I have the pleasure of introducing you to a recent recipient of the Tuck Scholarship Fund, final year B.Ed. Tiny Market, who has an inspiring story to share quickly.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. I believe that when we read, we speak to the minds, but when we talk, we speak to the hearts. Ladies and gentlemen, allow me today to share my story with you. I'm Tiny Maike from a rural remote area in Limpopo province. Being raised and born in a rural area is sometimes been perceived as a problem or rather a barrier to one's success. But I'm here proud to say that I experienced the other side of the spectrum. Despite all the challenges that I went through in life, in my primary and high school life, I managed to make it and thrived. And I was able to become resilient, hence today I'm here standing before you to say that life is possible. In 2012, I enrolled at the University of Pretoria as a first year. I must say that life was difficult, but despite all of that, I was able to become one of the top 10 achievers of Lilium Residence for the year 2012, 2013, and 2014. And also, I graduated for Golden Key Honorary Society in 2011 for being one of the top 10 academic achievers of this university. And also, as I speak, I'm currently a student teacher at Mamelodi Secondary School. Then why the question asked is that, why is education important? I believe that regardless of the situations that we go through in life, each and every individual can use education as a weapon to empower themselves to become better persons in the world. I also believe that initiatives such as Tuck Scholarship Fund can be used to raise the voice for those individuals who are seen behind the backs, those individuals who are voiced behind the back. Therefore, ladies and gentlemen, I'm proud to say that in my times of need, Tuck Scholarship Fund was able to reach out to my need. Therefore, I also pledge that next year as I'll be going to the work market, I'll also be one of the most faithful donors of this scholarship. Thank you so much.
I have no doubt that hearing Tiny's story evokes a strong sense of Tucky pride. These are the students that you were sponsoring when you donated the Tuck Scholarship Fund. There are brochures at our Tuck Scholarship Fund table that will give you donation options, debit order, credit card, as well as EFT. We also have this UP branded fridge magnet set up for sale for 100 Rand each. If you don't have cash on you, we can also get them from Bookmark where you can use your debit order form. Thank you very much for coming, and we look forward to connecting with you for the rest of the morning. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Cheryl, for those inspirational words, and also to our student. Thank you so much. I'm going to end this formal part of the morning and invite all of you to network and to take the opportunity to find out more. At some of your tables, there are people from FABI. If you have more questions on FABI, they will be very proud to and
supporting you in addressing those questions. So please enjoy the rest of the morning with us. Thank you very much.